tu sali. Io li vi poceti ovaj. Da otvaramo ovaj sad posljednji dio dana. S trećim panelom pod naslovom Mogući modeli za Europu i Balkan između politike i prava. A moderirat će ga poštovani zastupnik Maurizio Lupi, član italijanske parlamentarne komisije za vanjske i europske poslove. Kako možete vidjeti na ekranu, panelisti su Miruna Trompota, Adi Čerimagić, Jasmin Mujanović, Damir Kapižić i Jens Fölk. Hvala vam. Possiamo iniziare, onorevole.
Intanto buongiorno a tutti, buon pomeriggio a tutti. Ci eravamo lasciati con la conclusione del secondo panel con l'invito di un autorevole studioso italiano ad andare a un lunch. Il lunch credo sia stato soddisfacente ed è per questo che riprendiamo. Permettetemi, appunto, sono Maurizio Lupi, sono parte della delegazione italiana del Parlamento e della Commissione Esteri della Camera dei Deputati, che ha sostenuto con convinzione e cercando di mettere tutta l'autorevolezza del Parlamento, perché noi crediamo che la politica estera si svolga attraverso il ruolo dei governi e degli esecutivi, ma che la diplomazia parlamentare, rappresentando il popolo intero nella sua integralità, possa non solo sostenere l'azione di politica estera, ma renderla ancora più autorevole, proprio perché, ed è il valore di questa delegazione guidata dal Presidente Grandi, il Parlamento rappresenta la maggioranza e l'opposizione, chi governa e chi si oppone. Rappresenta l'unità e l'identità di un paese che si vede nel suo Parlamento bene o male rappresentato. È il protagonismo, è l'istituzione che rende protagonisti i cittadini. E allora che ci sia oggi a questo convegno, fortemente voluto dalla nostra ambasciata, appunto sul dialogo tra e sul ruolo che può avere questo dialogo tra Italia e Bosnia Erzegovina riguardo all'Unione Europea, credo che abbia un valore fortemente politico di sostegno, per sottolineare quanto il rapporto di amicizia tra i nostri due paesi sia fondamentale e di sottolineare anche, ed è il compito di questo terzo panel, quale ruolo dobbiamo avere, quali compiti abbiamo per arrivare all'obiettivo comune. Non a caso l'ambasciatore ha voluto un percorso in questo convegno ed è un percorso che ha i suoi step. Non si può partire dai modelli, oggi parleremo in questa sessione appunto di modelli possibili per l'Europa e i Balcani, il diritto, le negoziazioni, quali mediazioni, ma se si parte dalla fine non si va da nessuna parte. Si deve ripartire dalla ragione, ed è stato il valore delle due sessioni, dei due panel di stamattina, dalla ragione per cui un popolo si ritrova insieme, nelle differenze si ritrova insieme. Per cui è stato il panel precedente che lo ha sottolineato anche con molto vigore. Perché l'Europa? Perché aderire all'Europa? Perché oggi l'Europa è ancora attuale? Oggi è ancora attuale non solo per la Bosnia Erzegovina, ma è attuale per l'Europa stessa. Oggi il concetto di Europa è entrato in crisi anche nei grandi paesi fondatori. L'Italia, la Francia, la Germania sono paesi che hanno fortemente voluto, con tre grandi uomini, tre grandi personalità, De Gasperi, Adenauer e Schuman, hanno fortemente voluto l'Unione Europea. Oggi coloro che hanno dato la propria vita per fondare l'Unione Europea vedono quel progetto messo in crisi. Nelle diverse nazioni nascono si sviluppano i nazionalismi, i populismi, una reazione si vede l'Europa non più come un'opportunità, ma quasi come una cappa, come una sorta di delega dei propri poteri, di rinuncia alla possibilità. Viene meno anche, ed è venuta meno anche, quella ragione, sottolineata da alcuni, del benessere economico. Dal 2008, con la crisi economica, anche il benessere economico sembra essere stato messo in crisi. E quindi l'Europa diventa uno dei colpevoli di un benessere economico che scende. Allora, per l'Europa, per l'Italia e quindi anche per i paesi che vogliono entrare a far parte dell'Europa, c'è bisogno di riandare ad una ragione più profonda e più forte, che è una ragione politica, culturale, di identità, per la libertà delle persone, per il benessere dei cittadini, per la sicurezza dei cittadini. Oggi ho ascoltato gli esiti di, appunto, di questo sondaggio, in cui il primo punto per cui uno dice voglio aderire all'Europa anche in questo paese è la pace. La pace è un grande valore, ma perché la pace sia duratura ha bisogno di riconoscerne le ragioni per cui bisogna stare in pace. E le ragioni per cui bisogna stare in pace le si ritrovano nel fatto che siamo diversi, abbiamo identità diverse, ma c'è una ragione più grande che ci mette insieme, che è quel luogo geografico che si chiama Europa, che ha visto tante culture, ed è stato sottolineato nel racconto della storia, dei 155 anni della nostra ambasciata, ha visto tante culture incrociarsi, incontrarsi, l'ebraica, la cattolica, la musulmana, tutti con un'unica idea, l'uomo, la persona, la grandezza della persona di un popolo protagonista. Ecco, il tema di oggi, di questo terzo panel, è come, ed è stato il percorso che abbiamo fatto nei primi due panel di questa mattina, identità, storia, identità, cultura, politica, come, se recuperiamo queste ragioni, la politica e il diritto possono permettere di agevolare che queste ragioni diventino più forti. Quindi occorrono due compiti, il compito dell'Europa e dell'Italia nell'Europa e il compito della Bosnia Erzegovina. Qual è questo compito, politico e istituzionale? Come cambiare i modelli? Il presidente Fassino stamattina diceva 24 anni sono troppi. E poi qualcun altro sottolineava, attenzione, era una domanda finale del secondo panel, attenzione, è vero che 24 anni sono tanti e allentano la ragione e l'interesse e il desiderio di poter e l'opportunità di vedere l'Europa come una grande occasione. Però attenzione, oggi c'è un giudizio dell'Europa negativo sulla Bosnia, sui tentativi di quello che si sta facendo. Allora, noi dobbiamo lavorare oggi insieme proprio per capire, convinti che l'Europa è una grande opportunità e una grande occasione, e che il nostro dialogo può rafforzare questa opportunità, renderla ancora più concreta per le ragioni dette prima, dobbiamo capire insieme quale compito abbiamo e come sostenerci vicendevolmente. Ho finito questa mia breve introduzione e non a caso il primo degli speaker, a cui chiediamo di dare il suo contributo, oltre che essere un autorevole studioso, Miruna, vive in un paese che, la Romania, che ha aderito all'Europa come grande opportunità, è entrata successivamente quando l'Europa si è aperta, e credo che da studiosa ma da testimone possa aiutarci a capire come questa occasione enorme che è stata per la Romania l'ingresso in Europa non vada persa. Prego.
First of all, I wanted to express that I'm very delighted to have been invited and also to have a Romanian point of view in this very timely discussion on the future of the Western Balkans. And I'm also honored to see a lot of friends in the room and to be back to Bosnia, country of my heart. I will speak as an academic who is also trying to follow policy topics. Sometimes people in the policy creative field are very much criticizing academics for being a bit stuck and being very slow in reacting towards the very fast rhythm of events. And I myself had that opinion until I discovered on my own that it's a great privilege to be an academic and to have this luxury of seeing everything a bit detached from the moment they happen. And because we have to be very concise, I would look forward to hear the opinions of the other speakers. So I'll try to be very fast. So I have this 5 points that I want to make. 4 of them are about the past, because we try to understand what was the model of enlargement, and this could help us for the future. And I will have 1 point in the end for the future too. First, this is something the academics talked about for almost 2 decades, and it seems to be more actual than ever. The fact that the enlargement strategy for the Central and Eastern European countries, the so-called Big Bang group of enlargement countries, could not be replicated to the Western Balkans. And of course, policymaking and decision makers have needed almost a decade to formulate this very clearly. The model for the post-communist countries could not be replicated in the ex-Yugoslav countries. Well, I think it's obvious for everybody why, but of course, just I wanted to outline the fact that compared to the 90s, in the 2000s, so after the Zagreb summit and the Thessaloniki agenda, we had a different European Union, very different. We had a different European Union neighborhood, much more geopolitical, especially after 2014, but also I guess everything changed after 2008 and the war in Georgia. That was the moment when the more geopolitical stances started to appear in EU's discourse, which of course affected enlargement. And nonetheless, of course, the Central Eastern European countries are very different than a post-conflict region, Albania and ex-Yugoslav countries, which were facing multiple transformations, not just the change from communism to capitalism or to liberalism. So all the main actors have completely changed in the decade. So it was clear that we needed a new model, and unfortunately EU was very slow in changing this model. They realized that there was a need for a new Europeanization, something tailor-made for the Balkans. The second idea would be, of course, okay, not all the CE countries were the same, and I guess talking about the experience of Romania is very telling, right? Many countries in the Balkans are looking have been looking at Romania's example, Romania and Bulgaria, of course, in order to draw some lessons, right? And unfortunately, I think there were more negative lessons that have been drawn. And I think that was done on purpose also, because whenever we look only in one direction and we see some parts of reality, we can be very tempted to think that that is the only reality, right? So the fact that, of course, the EU membership didn't solve everything for Romania and Bulgaria does not mean that the membership per se is to be blamed, right? And unfortunately, some analysts or experts in the area using Romania and Bulgaria purposefully as negative examples have did a lot of distorting of realities. Now, I just wanted to share with you some interesting things that I think are very telling for the Western Balkans. First of all, Romania signed the accession agreement, official application for the EU in 1995, just 2 years after EU in 1993 announced that it would have the open membership door open. So it was all very fast, something that is unimaginable today in the enlargement track, right? Then, in 2003, at the Thessaloniki Council meeting, Romania was given the other date. It was announced that it could not enter in 2004 due to problems in rule of law and independence of judiciary and corruption, and it will enter on 1st of January 2005. 2007. So it was, Thessaloniki was an important moment both for Romania and the Balkans. And now, after 12 years of membership, Romania for the first time had the presidency of the Council of the European Union and has put the Western Balkans on its fourth main priority, which I guess it's also telling because it continued Austria and Bulgaria's policy to support the Western Balkans. Now, what is also, what it also needs to be said is that 3.4 million Romanians have left Romania in other EU member states since 2007. Imagine, it's like a sort of Bosnia leaving the country after the country became EU member. Of course, this doesn't mean that all of them left because they were looking for, I don't know, better salaries or they couldn't live anymore in Romania. I think that this also tells something about how citizens learned the lesson of democracy and Europeanness, because being European also means to be mobile and to be able to have opportunities in whatever other country you want to go. I think a lot of Romanians left Romania also because they wanted better schools, better roads. Maybe they were looking also for more predictability, which their country didn't offer. So I would say that this is a general European trend, not something specific only for Romania or Bulgaria or other perceived less developed countries in the EU. And I believe that this became also a huge internal political movement for Romania, because as you know, in the recent presidential elections, Romanian diaspora has had almost the power to practically make a huge difference between the two candidates. The Romanian diaspora now also claims to have a member of the parliament representative for almost 10% of the population. So it's a big political actor, transforming only in the 4 or 5 years. So diasporas and immigration should not mean only negative elements, should not mean the failure of Romania's membership in the EU. On the other hand, I think a possible failure of this membership, and it's not about the lack of activity of Romania's government, would be the fact that Romania still was not integrated in the Schengen area and in the Eurozone. I would say that the fact that the Schengen area has become so politicized, especially with a very polarizing discourse after the migration crisis, shows us that, and this takes me to the fourth point, that enlargement has become in the last 5 years extremely nationalized. We talk in academic terms about the nationalization of Europeanization, okay? We just like concepts, but anyway, the fact that we have been talking about that and we have started to see this becomes a reality, right? Now the European Council is the one taking decisions about enlargement. Before that, everybody was expecting that the Commission has this main ability. The Commission drives and gives recommendation and keeps pace with transformations in the countries, but it seems that after all these positive reports of the Commission to open negotiations with North Macedonia and Albania, still the European Council has the final decision. This means that enlargement is not only very much politicized inside EU, but this also shows that practically we have very little predictability at this point in the enlargement agenda, which was totally not expected because enlargement and conditionality were something very clear on paper. But in reality, it became a political game of, in open, let's say, not just behind the closed doors. And this takes me to the last point. We have citizens feeling that enlargement is extremely unpredictable. We have citizens feeling that there are member states that consider that some citizens should be considered second order citizens. And on the other hand, we have governments in the Western Balkans which are unpredictable, a huge lack of stability in the last year. We have the same elite just talking the talk and not implementing the required reforms, and at the same time blaming the EU for everything. So how could we get get out of this? How could we have a new model building on this element that I try to point here? We don't have to do the same that we did in Central Eastern Europe. We don't have to continue the nationalization of Europeanization, but we have to discuss about what kind of Europe we want. And I think this discussion on the future of Europe needs to include both civil society representatives and governmental representatives from the Western Balkans. Because between the Western Balkans and the European Union, it's a huge interdependence. Some member states try to act as if this interdependence doesn't exist. But actually, we have seen during the migration crisis that we all face the same threat. We all face the same problems. And I will just end with the last point. The fact that we have this internal division inside the EU, and of course increasing division Western Balkans and with bilateral issues not being solved, I think this favors the other players who are interested in the Balkans, because guess what? It's not only the EU interested in that. And the fact that these discourses that promote division puts in advantage other players in the Western Balkans is not as innocent as we could think. And I'll come exactly to the last point on Romania. The fact that Romania and Bulgaria are given in most on public discussion as a lesson learned of the EU, which made the enlargement negotiations much harder and the bar was set much higher because of us, I think it's part of a sort of, I wouldn't call it hate speech, but it's clearly directing attention only to some negative elements of the process, which are true, of course, but there are many other elements in the process, extremely positive, which are not as often mentioned in public discourse. So my invitation for students and for also policymakers here in the region would be to try to look at Romania and Bulgaria also with their extremely positive and helpful actions towards the region and towards acting as European Union members.
Grazie a Miruna. Adesso chiediamo a Dadi, dico solo i nomi così non pronuncio i cognomi, non perché sono miei amici da una vita, ecco, solo per noi italiani siamo abituati ad avere queste relazioni amicali veloci, pacca sulla spalla e via, e poi qualcuno direbbe altro, però Adi gli chiediamo appunto di svolgere il suo intervento. E anche qui, secondo me, l'invito che l'ambasciata gli ha fatto è un invito molto puntuale, interessante, perché lui è analista del European Stability Initiative. Quindi, di là. Stavo leggendo il curriculum. E quindi, appunto, politica e diritto, politica e leggi. Di fronte alla opportunità e alla crisi che sembra essere entrata del fascino dell'entrata in Europa, per chi ci deve entrare e per chi invece c'è. Qual è il ruolo? Come cambiare? Quali proposte fare? Due ore a disposizione, non c'è problema.
Thank you very much. I would first like to thank the organizers for their kind invitation. I will apologize immediately for speaking too much about Bosnia, but I think that Bosnia-Herzegovina has very few of these events where EU and the current state of the EU process is happening, and I think it's an important to discuss it. I will start with a fairy tale. I think everyone here is aware about Grimm Brothers and their fairy tale about the princess and the frog. What most of us know is the version that actually is not the original, that the princess kissed the frog and then the frog transformed itself into a beautiful prince. In the original version, what happened was that the princess saw the frog and she was so disgusted by the frog that she threw it against the wall. And then the frog transformed into a prince. And I think most of the things that were happening in relations between EU and the Western Balkans in the past year, but months reminded me somehow of this original fairy tale by Grimm Brothers. I think that there was an attempt to kiss us for a decade or longer, but nothing happened. And now we're being thrown against the wall, and we will see what will happen. I mean, fairy tales are fairy tales in the end. Let me go to the reality. And there are two realities in the past 1 month that I want you to take with you or that I want to discuss. One is the interview by the French president, Emmanuel Macron, for The Economist, where he has mentioned Bosnia and Herzegovina. And I don't think I need to repeat it for the Bosnians here or the diplomats here. In that interview, he said that Bosnia was a ticking bomb that is endangered by returning jihadists or fighters from Syria and other regions. And while it is interesting now to lament about the statement, et cetera, for me as an analyst and observer, it was quite interesting to see the reaction to the statement in Bosnia and Herzegovina. From civil society, analysts, young politicians gathered in Strasbourg, to Minister of Security, Chairman of the Council of Ministers, two out of three members of the presidency, all of them said that is not true. Our institutions have certain data that prove differently, that prove President Macron wrong. We are not the country that President Macron described. There is no such danger. And in the end, President Komšić said, if there is a danger, we need to work together to try to decrease it and try to bring it to the level in other areas. And the thing is, I didn't see, correct me if I'm wrong, that anyone in this country or observer of this country noticed that. There was one thing where everyone or most of the people in this country stood up and said, no, we have institutions that take care of that issue. Actually, we have policies, we have instruments, we have made sure that things do not go wrong. The other reality is the reality of Pazaric and what we have seen with the photos there, but also the genuine reaction by citizens of Sarajevo going in front of the parliament and the government, and the government reacting, for some of us too slow and too little and everything else, but there was a reaction. And last night we had a continuation of the debate where a politician from one party goes out and says, well, yes, there was some reaction, but this, and this was not that. Now the question for me is, how do we in Bosnia and Herzegovina connect these two realities? Well, President Macron's statement could have been throwing the frog against the wall, and what we have seen in Strasbourg with young politicians and reaction from civil society and the government, et cetera, being our transformation in a beautiful prince that defends itself, that is proud, that stands behind institutions that actually work. The other reality is this one of Pazaric, where we know, we see photos of things being wrong, but we are ready to stand up and demand things to be changed, and we see some small changes, and we demand even bigger changes. Next week, OECD will publish results for PISA studies. It will be the first time in the history of Bosnia and Herzegovina where our 14-year-olds and 15-year-olds were tested on basically what the education system in this country provides. And we're very proud of our individuals that win Olympic Games in mathematics, et cetera, et cetera. But what will PISA results show is that compared to other countries in the world, our education output is very low and is very bad compared to the rest. Now, question for me as an analyst, as someone who wants to see the change in Bosnia and Herzegovina and in the region, is can we use the energy that we've seen in the case of the statement by President Macron and Pazaric to try to say, well, wait, yes, our education is bad, output is poor, our students cannot be compared to other 14-year-olds and 15-year-olds in Europe and the world, but can we change it? Can we have a vision in next 5 or 10 years that our education system will be at the level that Slovenian is or that the Estonian was? That was, by the way, at the level of or very close to the level of current Bosnian one 20 or 30 years ago. And how do we transform that into concrete policies? And the big question is now, going back to the topic that was the excuse, is what is the role for the EU in what I'm explaining to you that I would like to see for Bosnia and Herzegovina? And I will have to share with you two data. One is Balkan Barometer, RCC. 60% of citizens of this country believe that Bosnia, that EU membership of Bosnia and Herzegovina would either have no impact at all, or the impact would be negative. And 1/3 of the citizens of this country do not believe that their country will ever join the EU. And this is, in my opinion and in my assessment, result of 20 years of actually talking about the European perspective, talking about future EU membership for Bosnia and Herzegovina, but actually not working on a concrete steps that lead to the EU membership. And there, I don't only see a problem on the side of Bosnia and Herzegovina authorities, but I also see a big problem on the EU side that actually, if you look into the details, and some of the people who have invested their careers in this process are sitting here, I hope that they will be able to share, but what you will see is actually that we never started with the process of getting to the EU until 2016, when we applied for EU membership. So having citizens who are looking at their promise of European perspective, the promise of EU membership, and the promise of their everyday life becoming closer or getting closer to the average of the EU, standards, etc., not being transformed into reality, have not given up, but have became tired of the vision that was given. I think that the opinion that was published in May and the reaction to it in civil society, among politicians and among citizens of this country, shows exactly that EU has lost a lot on its possibility to have impact in this country, because what it offers to politicians and citizens of these countries is either for them not understandable, or the second, which is even worse, and which is something I believe is closer to the reality, is actually nothing special and nothing much. What opinion in May 2019 did to Bosnia, to those that understand the EU process as it is being implemented, is that Bosnia stands 10 years behind Albania in the process, and that looking at what's happening now with Albania and with North Macedonia, it's not something that can motivate and bring people together. My last point is the proposal or the alternative that the chair has mentioned. My think tank believes that it's a perfect time to discuss the future of the EU enlargement process. How we got to the point to discuss the future of the enlargement process is at this point maybe less relevant or less important. What is important now is really to focus on the content. What do we do next? And we believe that it is important as a first point that European perspective for all Western Balkan countries must remain. And we are very pleased to hear both from President Macron and from other skeptics, such as Dutch Parliament, Danish Parliament, that they want to stick to the European perspective. I will remind you that the Dutch Parliament rejected two resolutions in June that said we will never open accession talks with Albania. They said we don't want to open accession talks now, but they've rejected to have a resolution that said we will never open the accession talks. We think that the second point is that the accession process must become merit-based. At this moment, it is not merit-based. If you look what happened to North Macedonia, the country got 9 times recommendation to open accession talks. 9 times it was blocked, some by Greece, other by France. If you look at what's happening with the visa liberalization for Kosovo, it's practically a political blockade that has nothing or very little to do with what happened. Almost everything that has happened with Bosnia and Herzegovina and the EU pact, from when it applied for EU membership in 2016, being told in 2008, 2009, 2010, no, please don't. We don't want you to apply for EU membership. That if we have to now deal also with Bosnia, it would be too much for us. It was not about Bosnia. was about someone. The third thing that we believe is that it must not create new divisions. So we can't have one process for Montenegro and Serbia, one process for North Macedonia and Albania, and no process for Albania and for Bosnia and Herzegovina and Kosovo. We need something that will be offered to all six countries at the same time. And the reason, the reason for that is because we want these countries to be comparable. We want these countries to compete among themselves in good ways. Fourth thing, which is very important, is that there needs to be a credible interim goal for all six Western Balkans. In that sense, French non-paper that has been discussed quite a lot is a step in the right direction, but what it misses is that it has seven steps that need to, hopefully in negotiations between EU member states, be transformed into two steps, where the first step would be basically the fifth stage of the French non-paper, which is basically an offer to Western Balkan countries that they can join single market and enjoy full four freedoms of the EU, something that was offered to Austria, Sweden, and Finland in 1989 as a first step or as a political compromise until the EU gathered a consensus that they actually want to enlarge on the EU. And this has to be offered to all six countries simultaneously, from Bosnia to North Macedonia. The reason for this is clearly motivation. It's something that I've discussed in the case of Bosnia. We need something that motivates countries in the region, but at the same time that motivates EU member states. We feel that at this moment, when you look at the process with Montenegro and Serbia, member states and the Commission to a great extent are actually not motivated enough to work with countries to genuinely push them towards what is needed to be a member of the EU. We think that with the membership in the EAA or European Economic Area and in the single market, that then there would be a sense of urgency to actually bring countries in the Western Balkans to the level that is necessary to be part of the single market. Because at this moment, with SAA and with all the other documents, basically protection of the EU single market happens at the border between Bosnia and Croatia. If they would be part of the single market, then the protection of the single market would have to be done by the by the institutions in Bosnia, by the institutions in Bosnia. Fifth basis is that moving towards this single market membership has to coincide with the cohesion. We need more money for the Western Balkans. If we compare Romania, it has same population as Western Balkans countries combined almost. The GDP of Romania is double as big as the entire Western Balkans. It's twice larger than the Western Balkans, and it gets 4.5 more money from the EU allocated than the whole Western Balkan countries. And if we want countries to work on their institutions, on rule of law, on all the other issues, the EU needs to support countries economically more significantly than that. And the last, and the last or concluding remark from me would be that the key point at this moment in this debate that we have is not to perceive it as an empty space where certain forces that we have seen last year, for example, that have discussed border changes and some of the narratives of the previous time would flourish, but we need to really show a seriousness both from the EU side, but from the side of the Western Balkans, in particular from the civil society, etc., that we want to engage very seriously in the debate what is actually necessary for the countries in the Western for the Western Balkan countries to change and to move closer to the EU average, because so far they have not succeeded to do that, either not fast enough or not enough. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Grazie, adesso tocca a Yasmin della Elon University, North Carolina. E mi è solo incuriosito nel dargli la parola l'ultimo volume che lui ha pubblicato, perché il saggio che ha pubblicato ha questo titolo, Fame e collera, crisi della democrazia nei Balcani. rappresentato nulla sin dalle diverse rivoluzioni che sono accadute nella storia a proposito della vita normale dei cittadini. È evidente che se i cittadini stanno male, la fame, la rabbia esplode e la democrazia non si capisce perché serva. Perché la democrazia è quella forma che in una comunità ci si dà per valorizzare la persona, per renderla più dignitosa, per renderla più viva, per renderla più vera. Quindi la sfida è sempre partire dalla concretezza e dal bisogno dei cittadini.
Thank you very much. It's a very good question, and it's a very good comment. I think I'll use my time to answer that question in a roundabout way, or respond to that comment in a roundabout way. I wanted to first of all to thank the organizers and the hosts for having all of us here. There was an interesting comment posed made at the earlier panel as to why most of the sessions were taking place in English or in other languages when we are obviously located here in Sarajevo. To my mind, I think it's a basic courtesy as to who invited you. You speak the language that you were invited in. And I think it also reflects the reality that Bosnian politicians, Bosnian institutions, and also Balkan institutions and Balkan politicians more broadly in this region do not generally create opportunities for their citizens to hold their feet to the fire. The sad reality is that when people like Adi and Damir and myself and their all of our colleagues here, when we have an opportunity to speak freely, we unfortunately have an opportunity to speak freely to folks from Italy, to folks from the United States, to folks from Germany, etc. That gets also to the question of democracy and what the status of democracy in this region actually is. I think when we're talking about the broader crisis that has been taking place in Europe and in sort of international politics more broadly, not just since 2016, not also since 2014. I think Miruna is absolutely right that we definitely have to date this to, at the very least, to 2008, and not just because of the financial crisis, but also because of the war in Georgia. The reality is there is very little new here, and there is very little news here either. Many of us who have been working on these topics, vis-a-vis enlargement, the different aspects of enlargement, writing, thinking, speaking more broadly on the topic of democratization, have, I think, spent many years and spilled a lot of ink and spent a lot of our time, some would even say our precious youth, pleading with our friends and colleagues in Brussels and the capitals and international community more broadly, to take seriously this region in the context of a political process rather than a technocratic process. 100,000 people died in this country during the 90s. Something like 150,000 people died in the context of the whole of the Yugoslav wars. We don't talk often enough about the scale of the political crisis in Albania after the collapse of the regime there in the early 1990s. This region always needed something much more substantive, something much more careful, something much more in tune with the historical realities that took place in this region than a kind of technocratic process. What we always needed, and what I think we're still searching around in the dark for, is a genuine commitment to building democracy in this region. And democracy is not just institutions, because we have many institutions in Bosnia-Herzegovina. We have too many institutions in Bosnia-Herzegovina. In fact, our friends in the EU helped us invent a new institution, a so-called coordination mechanism, which I'm waiting for somebody to initiate yet another lawsuit in front of the European Court of Human Rights. Because on the face of it, this is an unconstitutional body. Bosnia already has a coordination mechanism. It's called the Council of Ministers at the state level. So we have a surplus of institutions, but we have a deficit of substantive democratic processes. And we have certainly a deficit as far as our overall democratic culture is concerned. So how do you actually get there? What do you actually have to do? I believe in the context that we're in right now, and the context that this region has been in for the better part of the last, not just 20 years, I would say probably the last 30 or 40 years, we're missing one very specific ingredient. We can talk about it in a number of different ways, but we're basically missing the ingredient of consequences and fear. And specifically, it is a very specific group of people that is missing these ingredients, namely our political elites. Our political elites are not afraid, and they have faced no consequences, either from their own domestic citizenry or from the international community. In specific places like Bosnia, political elites face no consequences and have no fear because existing democratic institutional processes cannot hold them accountable, which is why for nearly 25 years, essentially the same cast of people have been in power without interruption. The most significant scale of transition that you've seen, for the most part, in Bosnia is that the sons of certain former leaders are now prominent politicians. That's about it. Have there been some minor new political actors that have emerged? Absolutely. Do they have very much significant power? No. If we look at more broadly, regionally, what is the nature of the so-called political elite in the Western Balkans? We need only remind ourselves of shall we say, the previous life of the current president of Serbia. I'm always puzzled, extremely puzzled, why no one has yet asked in any interview President Vucic as to what precisely it is that changed for him in his mind, in his heart, in his soul, that today he is an advocate for the EU, that he's an advocate for sort of reconciliation, that he is an advocate for the rule of law, whereas in the 1990s, as for instance during the siege of Sarajevo, he was literally driving around in trucks that had human skulls on the front hood. That's an interesting question. I would like to know the nature of his conversion, as it were. So, if you can't hold people accountable through institutional processes, because in almost all of these countries, we have essentially managed democracies, right? We have electoralism, pardon me, we have electoralism, but we do not have democracy. Votes are counted, elections take place, but there is no change in power. So there's no consequences. Our friends in the international community, likewise, for the most part, have unfortunately not done their part, notwithstanding the fact that they have spent tremendous resources, tremendous time, tremendous energy building institutions, building capacities. I do not want to be misunderstood and certainly to be characterized as being ungrateful for the tremendous positive role of individual countries like Italy, the broader European community, the United States, etc. Of course, they have done so much for us. If for no other reason, or if nothing else, in particular in places like Bosnia and Kosovo, you have given us the conditions for peace. And there is no greater value than peace. On the other hand, there's a serious question to be asked about the quality of our piece. And it is not a very qualitatively good piece, I suggest to you. And for the most part, the reason why that has taken place is that people have been allowed, political elites have been allowed to violate the terms of the piece consistently, routinely, on a virtually everyday basis. We've had a document that came out of the RS assembly a couple weeks ago, a 20-point document that apparently lays out the agenda of the current government in Banja Luka. I would suggest that if we were to go through each point of what that assembly has published, what it has said are its ambitions, what its policy objectives are, every single one of those points is not only at odds with the Dayton Constitution, it is at odds with the European project and, of course, the Atlantic project. Has there been any meaningful response to this? Has there been any meaningful consequences? Has there been any meaningful consequences to the creation of paramilitary forces? Has there been any meaningful consequences for clear and transparent violations of the writ and spirit of the Dayton Constitution? No. The United States imposed sanctions on Nikola Špidić and Milorad Dodik over the last 2.5-3 years. The European Union has not followed suit. So what can we actually do? What can we actually do? Where can we actually go forward? And here, I think Adi is very good. I think Adi goes to the nitty-gritty. He talks about the practical processes, very specific initiatives, and I subscribe to every single one of them. However, what I think we need more broadly is a political transformation. Accession, the nature of the EU-West Balkan relationship needs to be fundamentally political. It needs to be about values, about principles and commitments. And we heard that on the second panel as well. I am much more interested in both the short and long term that we have a collective and substantive commitment to building democracy and confronting those who undermine democratic politics and democratic values and human rights than I am in technocratic accession processes. In the short term, we also have a tremendous opportunity, and this is sort of one of the last things I'll say, and then hand it over to my colleagues and then obviously invite questions. We have an opportunity right now to combine the two, in the sense that in this country in particular, but in the region more broadly, we are once again, thankfully, talking about NATO. For Bosnia-Herzegovina specifically, but for in this entire region, NATO is existential. Because what it represents is a recommitment to peace. The thing that has largely begun to be undermined and has begun to almost dissolve in some cases, in particular in places like Kosovo and Bosnia. Hence, very alarming new ideas like border swaps. Right? NATO for us represents the opportunity to substantively reinvest in the basic security dynamics of this region. And once we do that, once we take away the toys from the people who have held power for 20, 25 years through fear and through threats of violence, and we end that conversation forever via NATO, then we can once again begin to have a meaningful conversation about democratization as both an institutional and as a grassroots process. That, I think, is also what I say in my book, as I recall. It's been now a little while since I've read my book. But I think that, in a sense, is what I would implore all of us to return to the politics of it all. And in that sense, there is an opportunity, even though I disagree with virtually everything that has come out of Paris over the last few months, there is an opportunity, however, given the changing nature of the conversation within the EU, for us to return to those first order principles. What does it mean to have a liberal democracy? What does it mean to have a liberal international order? Thanks.
Grazie a Yasmin, anche per la forza, la chiarezza e la sottolineatura del del compito della politica, della passione con cui lo ha fatto, perché la natura del compito dell'Europa deve essere politica, perché il compito della politica, e introduco quindi anche Damir, che è docente di politica comparata alla Facoltà di Scienze Politiche all'Università di Sarajevo, è il compito della politica, è costruire il bene comune. E per costruire il bene comune devi avere a cuore la vita dei cittadini e innanzitutto le caratteristiche fondamentali che fanno la vita dei cittadini, le libertà, la dignità, la possibilità di creare, costruire, di avere un futuro. Se l'Europa non dà questa prospettiva e non è questa opportunità di azione nella costruzione della democrazia, la politica ha fallito. Damir.
Thank you very much. I think that what I will be talking about is actually a good continuation of what Yasmin just concluded with, not with NATO, but the point before that. So we were warned before the session yesterday during a short consultation that there are very large expectations coming out of this, essentially trying to discuss new models, trying to discuss whether any current new models are actually workable, applicable, or is there something missing in all of this? And I'm not going to talk about models, because I think that's the wrong question. There's something missing in this if you only look at models as technical solutions to solve a single problem. Merit-based solutions, of course, they have to be a part of this, but there's again something missing, a heart, as the chair rightfully said. We must talk about a new narrative for integrating, or actually not even integrating, but for a new narrative for relations between the European Union and the Baltics, in light of possible future integration. Now, in order to come to this, I'll just take a little step back to the 2004 large big bang enlargement of the European Union. There were very strong narratives around this, narratives both from the East and from the West. In the East, you had a narrative of a return to Europe. We're going to come back to Europe after being outside for so long. In the West, there was this narrative of reintegrating Eastern Europe, in a sense that they were once part of us. For some time they were not, we're going to bring them back in. And of course you had a definition of all of this through the Copenhagen criteria. This was something that is still in effect. In the recent enlargements in 2007 and 2013, the accent of a return towards Europe or a reintegration got weaker and weaker and weaker. And what we have left right now is a set of technical criteria, a checklist that you have to fulfill. And this is a very good point that was actually made by President Macron. It doesn't work that way. You cannot entice and you cannot give your voters, because essentially it is a political issue, you cannot tell your voters that we should accept new countries just because they fulfill technical criteria. There has to be a narrative that also engages both people within the European Union but from outside. Now, in order to identify such a possible narrative, we from the Western Balkans and you from Western Europe, now I'm using this sort of you perspective here, have to ask ourselves a few very uncomfortable questions. First of all, what does the European Union want to achieve in the Western Balkans? Currently, it's security, migration control, and trade. That's it. There's nothing else that's on the European agenda, high on the European agenda. Of course, there are other issues. Those three are key. They're non-negotiable. Now, these three issues, they can also be achieved without democratic means, without European values, and with a strong authoritarian presence in the region. This is why we had Gruevski in Macedonia. This is why Vucic is strengthening in Serbia, with European support, by the way. So that's one hand, well, the one side of the coin. The flip side, what do Western Balkan countries want from the European Union? We really don't know that much what we want. We want membership, we want access to European Union funds, we want access to the freedom of movement and freedom of trade. But these are mostly formal criteria that we want. There's no substantial change involved in this. There's no acceptance of European values, of freedom, of equality, of liberty that come with this. You don't need those in order to achieve what we want. So again, everything is set on a checklist. Now, this is not a good way to approach the issue of integration. This focus on stability, on stabilization and development is basically failing. This was something that we can witness right now. There's no change and no fundamental change that can be achieved only by these mechanisms. And the agenda of the European Union, of European Union countries, and I have to say, even of the resolution by the Italian Parliament, has to move away from encouraging and supporting. That's not the way to go. Just by encouraging and supporting, nothing will change. So there is a new narrative that's needed. Now, what kind of narrative can we talk about? In this sense, we have to move towards something that's called foresight. We have to think about the future. We have to think about what we want the relationship between the European Union and countries of the Western Balkans to look like. Not for it to be a reactionary policy, because currently it's reacting towards fighters coming back from the Syrian battlefields, towards possible migration crises, towards demographic crisis. It's a very reactionary narrative right now. And the narrative that we have currently is Europeanizing the Western Balkans. Sounds all right. And of course, you always have the flip side of Balkanizing Europe as another threat that you don't want to achieve. Now, what's wrong with Europeanizing the Western Balkans? First, it takes away agency. There's no agency involved in this from countries in the Western Balkans. It's a one-way street. It's accepting. And also, there's no way of actually discussing and negotiating anything when you're trying to Europeanize. Now, you may talk about this new narrative in different forms. You may talk about it as a new deal for Southeast Europe. You may talk about it based on values of equality, freedom, and dignity. But there's also a need to talk to the European public about this. And currently, this is being avoided by most people. Now, the Balkans have a very special place in Europe. The Balkans are the others of Europe. We're pretty much close enough to be relevant for any European discourse, but again, different enough to always be referred to as the other, the flip side. And this is something that especially right-wing parties in the European Union are making use of today. It's something that is in your neighborhood and that you don't really want to identify with as being part of. But again, people know about this, so you can use this narrative, especially when you talk to anyone in Western Europe about the Balkans. The reaction that you get is not something that you would want to invite in your house. There's a need to rethink this. First of all, rethinking the actors who are involved in this story, and also about rediscovering, whether it's the Balkans or Southeast Europe or whatever other political formulation might come up in the next few years. So is it possible to achieve this kind of new narrative? And I'm not sure, I don't know. It's not something that can happen from today to tomorrow, but I think that actually there is no other alternative, because under the current narrative, change is not happening. Imposed Europeanization, something that we can see in Croatia, is actually backsliding. Democracy in Croatia is just falling in almost every single aspect except elections. And this need to securitize the Balkans from the side of Western Europe is something that definitely is not helping at all. It's something that definitely needs to change. Now, in this sense, what would be if change does not occur? What would be if we just continue, because European Union is sort of a mechanism that's very slow to change, and that continues for a long time without change. Now, what would happen if it does continue? And in this sense, I do not see that much of a bright future, because the countries in this region currently are experiencing a very strong emigration crisis. And it's not the poor, the hungry who are emigrating, it's the capable and the educated, especially those who have values similar to those in Europe. There's a famous article or popular article recently by Ivan Krastev who talks that it's easier to change the country where you live than to change your own country. And people are deciding to change the country where they live rather than fighting for change within, because they're not getting any support from anywhere. What you will have in the end is the Western Balkans, which is more backwards, more conservative, and more radicalized. So is this the future? Again, using foresight, is this the future the European Union wants to deal with? I'm not really sure. In order to not have that future, you need a new narrative. So that would be all.
Jens, professore associato di diritto costituzionale comparato presso la facoltà di giurisprudenza e dell'Università di Studi di Trento.
Sì, sì. Okay. Grazie mille. Io parlo non nella mia lingua, ma nella lingua che mi piace molto, in italiano, e anche perché poi è stato menzionato molto Trento, che mi rende molto orgoglioso che c'è questo legame che è personale, ma che è anche appunto la città, la comunità in cui vivo di solito. Adesso vivo a Sarajevo, per quello devo anche precisare che parlo nel mio ruolo da ricercatore, da studioso, e non nel mio ruolo del mio attuale lavoro qui a Sarajevo. Cerco di aggiungere che è difficile perché c'è stato già molto detto e io concordo con tante cose che sono state dette. Cerco di aggiungere qualcosa diciamo su un livello un po' più dettagliato, nel senso di entrare un po' nel merito del discorso tecnocratico che è stato criticato, e sono d'accordo che c'è una carenza di politica e un deficit di politica. Parlo di strumenti, io sono giurista, parto dalla base che è l'accordo di stabilizzazione e di associazione. E in qualche modo abbiamo un primo paradosso, perché quello che fa proprio l'Unione Europea, la nuova dimensione dell'Unione Europea, è proprio l'effetto diretto e la supremazia del diritto comunitario. Qui invece abbiamo una base contrattuale, un accordo internazionale che presuppone che cosa? Presuppone, come tutti gli accordi, la volontarietà, ovviamente il rispetto delle regole, ma anche la volontarietà di appunto attuare questo accordo, che va bene fino a un certo punto, perché questa è la seconda novità dell'Unione Europea. È un progetto in cui non ci sta chi è costretto a starci, ma in cui a cui si aderisce proprio perché si pensa che è un valore aggiunto e è un vantaggio stare dentro. Proprio la logica stessa dell'Unione Europea, oserei dire, si basa sulla volontarietà. E allora questo sarebbe in linea con la logica appunto anche del processo di adesione, perché la finzione è che si fa domanda e poi ci si prepara e poi si riesce ad entrare. Adesso è stato detto da quasi tutti che hanno parlato prima di me, è stato fatto riferimento alle varie crisi, vari livelli dell'Unione Europea, Brexit, Polonia, Ungheria per quanto riguarda lo Stato del diritto, per quanto riguarda i valori, però anche appunto nei Balcani la fatica di pre-adesione, e questo va. Allora si possiamo proprio chiederci, ci sono le basi effettivamente per soddisfare questo contratto, questo approccio volontario? Ci sono le condizioni per una trasformazione interna, questa europeizzazione che è stata proprio richiamata come appunto residuo e modello appunto dagli allargamenti precedenti? E qui la dottrina, il dibattito è andato a dire no, abbiamo bisogno di qualcos'altro, e qualche anno fa c'è stato un dibattito sul EU Member State Building, lo dico in inglese perché questo è il concetto. E cosa significa? Significa che facciamo due cose alla volta, costruiamo lo Stato, che ancora non c'è pienamente, e allo stesso tempo, altro paradosso, facciamo quello che è il futuro dell'Unione, di uno Stato membro all'interno dell'Unione Europea, diciamo allo stesso Stato che non è così importante che sia Stato, perché è integrato, cioè la sovranità, l'essenza di essere Stato, non è così importante perché tu fai parte di una grande comunità. Allora, questa è una contraddizione, in qualche modo, non è una contraddizione se si fa uno dopo l'altro, un passo alla volta, ma è una contraddizione logica quando si debbono fare questi due processi nello stesso momento, perché già il secondo passo da solo richiede forte immaginazione rispetto al mondo degli stati a cui eravamo abituati. E poi questo EU Member State Building presuppone anche una forte guida locale, assistita, come sappiamo e come vediamo ogni giorno qui in questo paese, politicamente, tecnicamente, finanziariamente, e anche indirizzata proprio dall'Unione Europea, ma con l'idea che, come poi nel futuro, una volta entrati, già ora siano le autorità locali ad attuare e a rispettare tutte queste regole dell'Unione Europea, che, ripeto, non sono giuridicamente vincolanti, che si basano da un contratto, e se io violo un contratto sono libero a farlo, devo pagare le conseguenze, ci sono sanzioni, ma non è come all'interno dell'Unione Europea. Allora, questo mi pare molto importante come base, perché questo in tante conversazioni, discussioni qui, non è così chiaro, è proprio un processo, almeno la finzione, volontario. Dove voglio arrivare? Voglio arrivare ai paradossi della condizionalità che si innesta in questo processo, perché anche lì è un altro paradosso, il processo è volontario, ma ho la condizionalità di cui parliamo sempre. E qui abbiamo, io identifico almeno 5 paradossi. Uno ho già accennato, è quello della sovranità. Quello che ho detto, che abbiamo una sovranità formale, anche tenere conto probabilmente più formale che sostanziale, perché gli stati sono in parte non ancora consolidati, in parte contestati, in parte non riescono a provvedere a tutti i servizi che i cittadini si possono aspettare da uno Stato. Abbiamo parlato di alcuni scandali anche oggi. E poi soprattutto non ancora in tutti gli stati della regione c'è una visione comune che cosa servono questi stati. Forse la visione di che servono forse come veicolo per arrivare all'Unione Europea poi non è più così importante, non è proprio una legittimazione troppo forte di questa dimensione. In più c'è la questione dei costi del cambiamento, di cui è stato già detto molto in questo panel, ma anche nella sessione precedente, soprattutto per le elite. Allora molto spesso è preferibile lo status quo invece del cambiamento. Poi abbiamo un importantissimo paradosso, e secondo me questo è proprio il centrale, c'è il paradosso del modello o del piano mancante, perché l'Unione Europea non ha un unico modello di statualità. E potrei aggiungere proprio qui in Bosnia, anche se ci fosse, sarebbe probabilmente non adatto comunque per la Bosnia, e forse anche per il Kosovo e la Macedonia, proprio a causa della diversa situazione demografica, minoranze, constituent peoples e altro. Il motto stesso dell'Unione Europea è uniti nella diversità. Allora è chiaro che non possiamo avere un unico modello, è chiaro che non possiamo dire queste sono le istituzioni di cui c'è bisogno e che basta copiare e mettere. E questo è difficile, perché da questo abbiamo una condizionalità teorica, astratta, però che deve essere concretizzata nel singolo caso, e questo è molto faticoso, e soprattutto questo richiede nuovamente un aggancio ad un sistema di valori e dall'altra parte anche un'idea, una visione interna degli obiettivi di tutta questa operazione e dell'idea stessa dello Stato che si vuole costruire. E poi anche il riferimento spesso facile agli standard europei, per questo motivo è molto, molto difficile, perché qual è la condizionalità? sta a livello costituzionale. Quale modello offre l'Europa per 16-15 e la sua attuazione in concreto? In astratto, certo, ci sono i valori, c'è la non discriminazione, ci sono i diritti, però come effettivamente tradurre questi e concretizzarli nella concreta situazione, nel contesto costituzionale bosniaco, che oserei dire oggi è anche molto diverso rispetto a 25 anni fa, anche questo perché stiamo parlando di cose dinamiche, allora questa è la vera difficoltà. E poi un paradosso un po' più leggero, ma altrettanto importante, il paradosso della buona volontà, perché questo è il carattere, la conseguenza del carattere volontario dell'integrazione, nel senso che non ci sono vere e proprie sanzioni per il deficit, la carenza della volontà politica, perché appunto vediamo le fatiche. Per fortuna adesso c'è una risposta a vari livelli, Consiglio, Commissione e Corte di Giustizia, alla questione della crisi polacca-ungherese per quanto riguarda lo Stato di diritto. Ma questo ci dimostra quanto è difficile, perché proprio l'assioma è quello della volontarietà, cioè un valore aggiunto, io lo faccio proprio per quello, non lo faccio perché sono stato costretto. E da questo si arriva al paradosso dell'assistenza, che mi sembra anche molto importante in questo paese, perché appunto la questione è che l'assistenza di solito è fondata su incentivi, ma non tanto su severe sanzioni, perché le sanzioni hanno lo svantaggio che io, come donor, come finanziatore, come quello che presta assistenza, rischio a danneggiare quello che voglio costruire, e questo proprio l'assistenza la faccio proprio per l'obiettivo contrario, e questo automaticamente, purtroppo, per fortuna, comporta che c'è spesso poco bastone e tanta carota, proprio perché si vogliono creare degli incentivi. Arrivo all'ultimo paradosso e poi avrò due osservazioni finali, è quello del paradosso dello specchio, la questione di cui stiamo parlando tutto il giorno. Da una parte c'è l'Unione Europea, dall'altra parte ci sono i Balcani, e questi sono vasi comunicanti, sono in relazione l'uno di uno spazio con l'altro, e la capacità e la presa effettiva dell'Unione Europea dipendono dalla sua stessa attrattività. E per questo è così fondamentale, e anche lì non è una coincidenza, che secondo me l'anno 2006 in Bosnia è lo stesso anno in cui l'Unione Europea, dopo il fallimento del Trattato Costituzionale, comincia ad andare, ufficialmente era stato chiamato periodo di riflessione, ma in verità andare in crisi, no? E poi c'è la crisi economica finanziaria, la Brexit, tutte questioni che non sono ancora risolte, non abbiamo delle risposte, e concordo il merito della proposta o del veto francese dell'intervista è che si parla sia del futuro dell'Unione Europea sia dell'allargamento nuovamente in una dimensione più politica, ed è questo è essenziale, perché solo se riguadagniamo dinamicità, riguadagniamo appunto dinamicità nel processo, riusciamo probabilmente a diventare nuovamente credibile e superare questa questione e questa situazione, scusate, dello status quo. Ecco, per arrivare alla fine, io penso, adesso purtroppo ho già parlato tanto, e per la verità era anche un po' per mascherare che delle soluzioni non posso tanto offrire, però vorrei dire due cose un po' più concrete alla fine, dopo questa analisi dei paradossi, che spero possa servire per superare questi paradossi e appunto ovviare questi ostacoli. Allora, le due cose sono, da una parte, secondo me un'esigenza forte, è stato richiamato alcune volte, di rafforzare la dimensione regionale nel contesto dei Balcani occidentali, accanto a quello bilaterale, prima perché non possono esserci, come è stato detto, nuove divisioni, e per il ricorso alla dimensione di il riferimento alla dimensione di sicurezza. Poi anche proprio per il discorso importante dei valori comuni e per sperimentare la cooperazione anche a livello orizzontale, mentre ci si muovono tutti verso l'obiettivo comune. Questo mi sembra un punto fondamentale. Il secondo, forse sono troppo influenzato dalla mia attuale esperienza professionale in questo paese, un forte focus sull'attuazione. non c'è bisogno di tanti nuovi piani di azione, di riforme attualmente, ma ci vuole proprio anche la coerenza nell'attuare, ci vuole un monitoraggio serio, una valutazione, una ridiscussione di alcune cose che sono state attuate e questo secondo me aggiungerei non solo dai tecnici ma anche, almeno dove possibile, dai cittadini di aprire il dialogo e ricordo che una settimana fa l'Unione Europea ha organizzato questo dibattito sullo Stato di diritto, Pravo na Pravu, che è stato un tentativo, poi possiamo discutere se ha funzionato, se non ha funzionato, se si deve cambiare, però l'idea di coinvolgere anche direttamente e più spesso i cittadini mi pare molto importante perché l'obiettivo è comunque quello di una trasformazione sostenibile e solo se questa trasformazione pervasiva raggiunge anche la società possiamo sperare che questo obiettivo sia raggiungibile. Grazie mille.
Bene, mi sembra che il percorso l'abbiamo concluso, adesso c'è un quarto d'ora di tempo per domande, riflessioni. Gli spunti ce ne sono stati molti. Un librone di domande. Prego, lì.
Lo dico in italiano, ve l'ho detto, non hanno più le forze.
I speak in English this time. Thank you very much. I found personally this extremely stimulating and while listening to you, I just realized how many models of integration are active today in Bosnia-Herzegovina? The first one is inherent to the country itself. This morning, Asmin Mujkić was talking about how the idea of Bosnia-Herzegovina as a single state, not being only Serb, not being only Croat, not being only Muslim, but everything together is already an interesting example. And then we see the idea of integration in NATO, the different models of integrating with the EU, the idea of integration itself, as Daniel mentioned, how it changes. And if I were not representing Italy here, if I was on your side, I would like to ask to people like Jens, for example, and to the European Commission, would it be possible to think of some system, some legal system, to make it automatic to have control from above about the internal legal system? If possible, you know, Montenegro is not part of the euro area, but they decided to adopt the euro, which means they need to follow the EU central bank. Bosnia-Herzegovina is doing the same, actually, because they have a fixed exchange rate. Could Europe offer to extend the authority of the European Court of Justice to acceding countries so that citizens can have access to the highest level to get protection? Probably this is something the EU and the Commission and the Court of Justice would not like, that you might have too many cases coming from the Balkans. But something like this, an automatic system of superior control, would work, maybe. We already had something like this. The Sejdić-Finci case is an example through the European Courts of Human Rights. But it's also the example that even if you have a final judgment from outside, then you cannot enforce it. So maybe we should try to link those judgments with funds, with other activities. I don't have a solution for that. This is more of a comment, but maybe it's some area which in the future will attract more or should deserve more thought. So I leave it to the other guests to interact. Thank you.
much. My name is Ismet Fatih Çançar. Before I say my thing, I'd first like to thank everybody in the panel for talking and the Italian embassy in Bosnia for actually doing something like this. As somebody that's been outside and came back, opportunities for actual talk in Bosnia about these processes are very, very little, and actual talk about political change in Bosnia is very, it's non-existent basically, so thank you for that. Apologies for coming like this. My question is half a question, half a comment, but I'll do practically. We have been witnesses these recent months, especially this month, about several resolutions that have been adopted in the smaller entity in this country that have been plain and simply completely against what the EU stands for. Everybody here is more or less familiar with the opinion that has been given to Bosnia, in which the role of the state has been pronounced as the most important one. And then you have several resolutions within the entity that actually work towards releasing the power or transforming the power from the state back to entities, questioning and deriding common institutions within Bosnia-Herzegovina, basically everything anti-Dayton and anti-EU that we actually are here striving for. With all due respect to all the panelists, I have not heard about models that actually tackle these issues in Bosnia-Herzegovina. In my opinion, this country, beyond all geopolitics that we have present in the Balkans as a critical region, we lack tools and issues that would handle and tackle current problems in the country. The drift of Bosnia showcases all the falsehood of the presumptions that have been on both sides of Atlantic, that the march of deepening democracy in the Balkans and consequently Bosnia-Herzegovina would happen on its own. That's a fallacy of transitional countries in general, or the political backwardness of political and democratic processes and institutions of actually holding accountable actors for their actions. To evolve society in Bosnia-Herzegovina, in my opinion, requires patience, but more importantly, requires social force and an engagement from international actors in collaborating and including citizens and actively being part of this society and freeing the society from the endemic corruption and the power of the political elites this country has. The only one that has talked about that has been Mr. Yasmin. The single market, in my opinion, is not an answer. The only sense of urgency the single market would be is make a sanitary, clean region in heart of Europe that puts Western Balkans as something, you know, to the side. People and generally, it's psychology of people. When political shocks happen, people tend to compromise and accept lesser solutions because, well, you know, it just happened. The bombs from Paris that happened from President Macron gives a solution for something like that. But in my opinion, the solution is much more realistic and much more pragmatic. Exerting real pressure, both political and financial, and for some reason there's a word that people are afraid of nowadays, the sanctions that certain political elites require in Bosnia-Herzegovina is the way to open true reforms, because that is what's going to happen within the Western Balkans. The Western Balkans need to understand that true reforms is the way to enter the European Union, not window dressing through financial means and merit-based processes that somebody is going to decide what's merit and what's not. What's merit in the process of the new non-paper of French? How is Macedonia going to be assessed on that? Will they skip three stages, or will they start one? For those that are not aware, Macedonia actually stands better in several basic laws, or the basic criteria than Serbia and Montenegro that are ahead in the European Union. Who's going to actually, you know, decide that? Okay. So just to finish, the questions, everybody, I mean, the realistic people, people who think clearly, clearly understand that the way Bosnia is going to become, and the Western Balkans are going to become member of the European family, is by tackling the biggest issues first. We are not going to become a member of the European Union and not going to become a member of NATO without constitutional changes, which would completely revamp the process in this country. And for that, window dressing models of financial assistance is obviously, and I don't want to be understood differently, is helpful, but is not going to lead to real reforms that this society needs, that this country needs, the patronage system, the clientelist system in the country, the endemic corruption, the 250,000 people that left, labor-ready people that left from 2008 to 2018, et cetera, et cetera. Thank you very much.
Grazie.
My name is Said Iskalić, and first of all, I would thank you for organizing this conference, and I would like to continue on Bosnian, so I wouldn't mess with anything else. Prvo, želim se zahvaliti govornicima, gdje se vidi još da vrije balkanska krv u vama i da ste još puni energije i svaka vam čast. Najviše bi se složio vjerovatno sa gospodinom Jasminom, koji kaže da postojeća garnitura ne može uraditi promjenu koja nije već 25 godina uradila, i upravo ono što je spomenuo, a to je kažnjavanje. Oni ne osjećaju strah, jednostavno. Majka koja je rodila svoje dijete, koje najviše voli, prvi put kad dijete nešto pogreši, porazgovara sa njim. Drugi put ga kazni za njegovo dobro i da se promijeni. I mislim da prije svega treba uraditi na tome, jer mi svjesni smo i vidimo konstantnih problema sa korupcijom, i rade to otvoreno, više transparentno. To je došlo do ljudi na ulicama gdje razgovaraju o direktnim slučajevima, i naše tužilaštvo ne radi ništa po tom pitanju. Postoji sistem da se to riješi, koje jednostavno ljudi na ulici zovu spavača. To je OHR, koji ima čak i ovlasti da djeluje u tom polju i mogućnost da direktno kažnjava odgovorne osobe na razne načine. A mi vidimo da godinama nikada nisu povučene ili korištene te bonske ovlasti. I onda imate situaciju da jedan od članova predsjedništva govori da ta zemlja nije moguća. Zamislite neku drugu zemlju, bilo gdje na svijetu, gdje predsjednik kaže ta zemlja nije moguća. A imamo mogućnost da budemo najjača diplomatska zemlja. Imamo tri predsjednika. Zamislite u isto vrijeme da sva trojica odu i rade u korist ove zemlje. Mi bismo za jednu godinu, tri godine mogli imati. Da jedan ode u Ameriku, jedan ode u Rim, jedan ode u Brisel. A to je naravno sada ovako nezamislivo, kad se ne mogu ni dogovoriti vjerovatno i koju kafu piju na tim sastancima. Ali mislim da je ovo prvo put da se uradi integracija ove zemlje, a onda da se krene ka EU, jer EU je kao da vas pozovu u poznate svatove, skupne svatove. Svi se mi obradujemo da idemo prema tamo, ali to znači priprema. To znači da vi se morate dobro se obući, morate biti svjesni da idete uzeti veliki poklon. To traži vremena i pripreme, a to je zapravo ono što mi sada treba ovdje da radimo. Prvo, konsolidacija unutar naših redova, da bi mogli pristupiti tako velikim svetovima kao što je Evropska unija. Hvala vam.
Da in fondo.
Paolo Bergamaschi. In 2014, the larger process was put on hold, basically, at the beginning of the Juncker period. It was simply neglected, forgotten, a simple presumption. The European Union thought it had the monopoly on the Western Balkans. 4 years later, all of a sudden, Juncker was forced to take it out of the drawer and to declare once again that Western Balkans were again a priority, because in 4 years, Western Balkans were, because of bad management of the European Union, were turned into an area of competition between the EU, Russia, China, and Turkey. So that was the big discovery, all of a sudden, of the European Union. Now, something has changed in between. Western Balkans are again on the screen, but with a lot of problems. Now, I want to ask the speakers. First question, the Balkans need the European money, because at least for this, the European Union is good for cash. There is a lot of money coming in, poured into the Balkans without real visibility, because people do not understand where the money comes from. It's just international money, it's EU money, there is no visibility. So from this point of view, the EU is not able to win hearts and minds of people, but at least from an economic point of view, there is an incentive. Now I'm asking you, for the next multi-annual financial perspective, I don't want to enter a technicality, but the envelope, the money that will come to the Balkans for the next 7 years, is still a lot of money, because if I'm not wrong, it's 14 billion euros coming here in the next 7 years. Now, there is a big discussion, I know, in the lobbies of the EU, whether this money should be allocated in a flexible way that is more conditional, whether we should apply the principle of more for more, that is, the more you engage in reforms, the more you get EU money or not. So this is just a question. But altogether, I think that disenchantment towards the European Union is not something that runs through the Balkans. And I wanted to add something to what Mr. Kapicic and Mujanovic said before, because I think that we need a new narrative for the Balkans. This is true. We need a new narrative for the Balkans, but we need a new narrative for the European Union inside the European Union. We need a new narrative for the US democracy. We need a new narrative for liberal democracy as such, because we should understand that the Balkans are in crisis, but the EU is in crisis as such. So, I mean, there is something that has to change. We must get back to the original soul of the European Union. This has been lost on the ground, because the more the process of enlargement goes on, the more people get frustrated, this is clear. But I want to conclude with a note of optimism. Sometimes I don't understand the polls, because that shows a bit of schizophrenia, the polls. The people say something in the polls and then behave exactly the opposite way. So the EU is in crisis, the idea of European Union, of Europe as such, is in crisis. But then when we go to the polls, that is last June, we went to the polls, people knew, went to the polls, and the overwhelming majority, when they were called to choose between the European project or reduce or go back to sovereign forces and so on, they chose for Europe. So in the end, we need a new narrative, but please, let's remember that if people are called to choose, if people understand when they have to choose, maybe they use their vote with some responsibility.
Allora direi che possiamo fare un giro di risposte. Inizierei da Adi.
Yes. Let me maybe just address a couple of issues. The shock that happened in the last month and a half in the Western Balkans and in the EU and in relations between the EU and Western Balkans is that a country like North Macedonia has been stopped by a veto, by non-agreement, by a single EU member state. And what happened, what came out from that shock is the fear that all of us, or all reformers in the region and all those in the EU, and there are many of them who want to see Western Balkans reforms happen, is that they will be treated in the same way as North Macedonia was. What happened with the decision in October, that it became obvious and clear that the process of EU enlargement is no longer, or has not been for quite some time, a merit-based process.
doesn't depend on what you do or what you don't do as a country wanting to join. I want to stress out, because maybe I wasn't clear, what Macron explained when he explained his decision to do that was he wants to keep the European perspective, but he doesn't see countries of the Western Balkans at any point joining the EU as it is today. He puts priority on the reforms inside the EU. And we need to, when we discuss what are the policy options for us who are interested in changes in the Western Balkans, need to be aware of that. And he's not single, he's not the only one, who thinks that at the moment. So when we go out and say what is, what Damir said, what is our interest, we need to take into account the positions of different actors inside the EU and their visions of the place of this region in the EU and in the current debates. To your question, is the same question. I always try to turn it around. What I ask diplomats that I meet is, when was the last time you succeed in doing in getting something be done in Bosnia as in the way that you did? I ask that in DG Mir. I ask that in bilateral ministries of foreign affairs. So don't ask, like, let's turn around and tell me, when was the last time you were successful? And can you answer to me the question why you were not successful or why you were successful in doing that? And you will be surprised in how many positive answers you will get. From the success in the summer when it comes to this special military in the Srpska, to roaming in March, to some of the Erasmus things that were happening earlier this year, to having a reform program that is somewhere in the safe in the presidency of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And then the question goes back to you in a sense, is also what the proposal that I laid out or that the ESI is arguing for. We want to see EU actually having something to offer to the Western Balkans that is interested not for six leaders in Bosnia and Herzegovina or three or four more leaders in the Western Balkans, but that can bring together more people. Some will be interested in the trade part of the offer that the EU has. Others will be interested in opportunity that rises with the interests in the country that could be pushed to rule of law issues or values or other issues. But what we are saying and what I'm trying to explain to many is that we're lacking the basic offer from the EU. And I cannot stress enough how demotivating the atmosphere in the EU is towards Western Balkans membership. In Sofia in 2008, EU member states rejected the possibility of Montenegro and Serbia maybe being ready to conclude the accession treaty in 2025. The opinion that the European Commission published on Bosnia and Herzegovina de facto means that our membership is 20, 30, 40 years down the road. That is the message that we as a region have received in the past year or 2 years. Now we can sit and discuss and hope and come up with all the different things that we would like to see from this liberal values, from the narratives, et cetera, et cetera. But at least I see myself, or I want to argue a single part, and that is to start from basically from the basics, explaining to the EU, but also to the Western Balkans, that there is nothing at the table that is being offered, and that we need something to be offered at the table. We need to start from something. And in that sense, the comments on financial instruments, I fully agree with you. Bosnia and Herzegovina is a prime example that with money, you can't buy the decisions in the country. We have seen the blocking of the highway money. We have seen IPA funds being cut, but without results. We have seen a country that has had several. So when we say we need, or when ESI argues in favor of more money for the Western Balkans, it's not a part of the bargain between the EU and the Western Balkans. It's a part of the need for the region and for the EU to invest in development of the Western Balkans. We are, at the moment, a according to the to the assessment, be it from the GDP to the actual productivity level, to the trade, to the surfaces, to many other respects, we are lagging extremely behind the EU. So when someone comes and says, you know, but Romania is doing bad as well, then you have to put it in perspective with the Western Balkans, and you have to conclude that, Romania is something that at this point, in many respects of the economic and social life, would be something that would be good for the Western Balkans. So I don't know if I will stop there because I took it long, but what I want you to carry out, and that is my response to many of the questions and the comments here, is that we need to be aware of what is at the table in Brussels for us at the moment, that the offer for us is being discussed, and that we need to be clear that we want much, much more in order to have a dynamic in our country that would lead to the progress.
Grazie. Io vorrei fare una risposta, dare la possibilità di una risposta a tutti, quindi dobbiamo essere assolutamente sintetici. Miruna.
Very quick. It was a lot of talk about EU conditionality, and if this element should still be on the table or should be replaced by something totally different. Well, I think we are missing the fact that conditionality has at least three dimensions. It is the very technical language that is usually in the European Commission reports, which is the conditionality on the paper. Then there is the conditionality as a process, which is a result of interaction between different administration and different levels of government and the EU, and hopefully civil society. So I think we need to think of conditionality also in terms of practice, not only on what is in a dead language on some papers. And the other element is something that binds these two together, which gives actually meaning to what is on the paper and to what are people actually doing. And that is credibility. You know, we all the time talk about the fact that conditionality needs to be credible, and there is a need of commitment in order for it to work, right? This is how it was invented as a behavioralist type of mechanism that gives carrots, and also on the same hand, at the same time, it also punishes when things are not going well, right? So this part of conditionality, credibility, is clearly lost. I felt this in almost any speech for today. But on the other hand, the need for hope, the need of new narratives, is still on the table. So how to make conditionality credible? When two very important things, I think, happened this autumn, even maybe this month, I mean, in October. I will just attract attention of the new commissioner proposed by Hungary, which is now commissioner in the von der Leyen team, proposed by Hungary, who is Eurosceptic and who does not have direct, you know, interest in the Balkans or the neighborhood. He will be the one leading the future sort of discussion and policy in the name of the European Commission. I think that is extremely problematic. And the second is the fact that Serbia signed to become a part of the Eurasian Economic Area, which is the main economic alternative proposed by Russia. And that happened, you know, almost simultaneously with the France's position, right? So with these things on the table, which are extremely political, I think conditionality needs to be rethought as a practice, not as something on the paper, which certainly didn't work for the last 10 years.
Grazie.
Yasmin. I think really quick, because I would like to go and have a drink. I'll be extremely quick, and I kind of want to actually answer a question that Diamond posed as a way of answering most of the other questions. What is the new narrative? What is the one thing that combines, I think, the experience, the historical experience of the European Union and the very specific historical experience of the Western Balkans? And that is the experience of war, because the EU is fundamentally a peace project, and we have lost sight of that because we spend too much time, understandably, talking about technical prospects
but we do not talk about why European states spent 70 years integrating at every conceivable level, because they never wanted to go through something like the Holocaust again, they never wanted to go through something like fascism again, they never wanted to go through something like World War I, or essentially the entire 19th century, right? So when you're talking about that narrative, that is what brings us together. And we have very, very sharp divergences and cleavages on the technical aspects, where we are with our economies, with corruption, with political institutions, with democracy, da 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 da. But the thing that we want and need, and likewise can offer you in turn, is a reminder of the consequences of cause when you do not undertake this kind of collective action. Because what happened to us after 1989 is the lessons not learned after 1945, right? And so when we think about what do we want to do after 2019, right, that's the conversation we want to revisit. Revisiting the lessons of 45, revisiting the lessons of 89.
Damir. Yasmin ti ha risposto, quindi sei finito.
Again, I will also be very quick. A few years ago, if you would have asked me what are possible solutions to sort of bring more motion into this whole idea of Europeanizing the Western Balkans, I would have said bigger carrots, bigger sticks. I'm not that optimistic about that any longer. Basically, conditionality by itself does not change values. This has been shown again and again, and we see it even in countries such as Hungary and Poland today. Money does not create freedom and democracy. We have seen that again and again in different aspects. So what is it that we need in order to move forward in any sense? I mean, you need carrots, you need sticks, and they need to be bigger than they currently are, obviously. You need partnership. You need a partnership based on equality between the two parties. And you need opportunity. Basically, each partner needs to discover an opportunity in engaging with the other. Currently, the European Union does not see this opportunity to engage in the Balkans. It's for stabilization, but they can achieve that by other means. The Balkans does not see a clear opportunity in engaging with the European Union because the reforms required to do so undermine most of the political class which are currently in government. So, and these questions of equality, partnership, opportunity, it's not just in between these two blocks of countries. It's also something that the countries themselves internally struggle with. The Yellow West movement, West movement in France struggles with the same questions. The rise of the right in Germany struggles with these same questions. And Brexit is an outcome of these same questions. Opportunity is missing. Equality is, nah, not really there. And there's no partnership of the political elite with their electoral support. So we need to discuss these three things. Quality, partnership, and opportunity. And we might be able to build a new narrative for Southeast Europe and try avoiding the term Balkans, because that is very securitized right now, in order to move forward.
Infine, Jens.
Okay. For this last remark, I was a bit provoked by Adi when he said that the EU what does the EU have to offer? And as a German, or but let's say as a Western European, I would say, why should the EU offer something? There should be a genuine interest to get your own state working and functioning and right. And there should be an own interest to do something for the citizens, to have a value system. So why should it be the EU to offer something in order to trigger all this? And I think here's the elephant in the room, and this goes to the questions also from the floor. The question, what kind of system do we have in Bosnia-Herzegovina? Because the article of the European Union, the article 49 of the 48 of the European Union says that states can become members of the European Union. Very simple, states. And now the question is, which kind of state? And again, what I said before, there is no model. So there are federal states, there are regional states, there are unitary states, but states. And so we need to develop a common vision of this state, because otherwise we will hear we will be here in 15 years, in 25 years, in 30 years, and we will discuss very similar issues. Of course, then the EU might have changed in the meantime, but I think this is the problem. The change has to come from inside, and this is also an answer, and I would even say as a constitutional a scholar of constitutional law, even bad constitutions can work if there is a will to make them work. So I would personally be in favor of constitutional change, and the opinion says this, but even a bad constitution might work if there's a will to make it work. And in part, this is also the answer to the ambassador's suggestion, kind of automatic external control. Again, the principle is domestic authorities bear the burden of European integration. We do not have a European Commission bureau in every single city of every single member state. No, because the Italian, the Greek, the German, the Dutch, the Romanian authorities implement European Union law. It's a kind of, I shouldn't say the word, but a kind of federal system. Or at least it's a federal feature, let's say it like this. And so this, in a way, is also possible because, as I said before, direct effect, supremacy, binding rules everywhere. And then we go to the Court of Justice in case our national courts first do not comply. So I don't want to be too technical, but the question is here, in the moment when we insert external control here, this is a clear question that this system doesn't work, that there is no trust in the system. So this is a kind of surrender, if we want to see it like this. And this is what happened in Albania with the vetting, which is now also sometimes discussed here in this country as an extreme means. But it's an extreme means because other normal things do not work. The change, which has to come from within in order to be sustainable, doesn't work. And this is surrender. This is not a sustainable basis. Thank you.
Grazie. Per concludere, anch'io faccio un'unica battuta, se la nostra carissima amica me lo permette e non mi caccia. Grazie mille. Perché credo che, lo dico appunto da rappresentante del Parlamento italiano e da di un paese che è fondatore dell'Europa, che lo scossone che sia Jasmine che Damir ci hanno dato sia la questione centrale. Quando hanno continuato a dire qual è la narrazione, dov'è il cuore? I soldi non fanno un'unità di popolo. Continuate a parlare di Balcani, perché non parlate di Europa? Ecco, io credo che se abbiamo aspettato 24 anni è perché è mancato il cuore. Perché sono prevalsi gli aspetti tecnici, le regole, che sono sempre una conseguenza del cuore. Perdonatemi, non si tradisce una persona se la si ama. E quindi ci si dà delle regole. Ma se non si ama la persona, le regole non le rispettiamo. Ecco, il problema dell'Europa e dei Balcani vale per l'Europa, ma vale anche per l'attacco che alle elite istituzionali, alla classe politica che ha governato i Balcani in questi anni. È esattamente questo. E allora, nell'ultimi 30 secondi, visto che ci sono tanti giovani e che ha fatto bene l'ambasciatore anche a partire dalla memoria storica, perché senza storia non si ritrova il cuore. Ci sono tanti che nel 1989 non erano neanche nati e quando è finita la guerra nel 1995 non erano neanche nati. Io quando ero giovane all'università ero affascinato da una figura di un politico non italiano ma amante dell'Europa che si chiamava Václav Havel, che era un grande intellettuale, dissidente nella Repubblica di Cecoslovacchia, che poi fu fondatore della rivoluzione di velluto. Nel 1989, senza violenza, divenne presidente della Repubblica di Cecoslovacchia. Ecco, Václav Havel diceva in quegli anni, dalla carcere, che la speranza non è l'ottimismo, non è la convinzione che le cose vadano bene. non è la convinzione che ciò che stiamo facendo avrà successo. Ma la speranza è la certezza che quello che stiamo facendo ha un significato, indipendentemente dall'esito. E quindi ritorniamo alla provocazione per l'Europa. Non è un caso che l'Europa è in crisi anche per l'Occidente. È la speranza, diceva Havel alla fine, e giovane universitario insieme a tanti altri universitari italiani ci mettemmo in moto, o è in noi o non è in noi, o ce l'abbiamo o non ce l'abbiamo. E questo è per le classi politiche, per le élite, cioè per chi deve guidare, deve ascoltare il popolo, lo deve rappresentare, si deve rimettere in discussione, ma ha anche un grande compito, quello di guidarlo. Grazie a tutti.
Već govorilo o Nade, nadam se da ste vi preživjeli. Zaključujemo prvi dan pozivajući vas na sutrašnji s početkom u 10 sati ovdje, gdje će se odviti četvrti i završni panel pod naslovom Prepričati Balkan kroz regionalna pitanja i međunarodne odnose Balkan i Europa u medijima. Hvala vam svima na sudjelovanje, srdačan pozdrav svima, molim vas, od nas. Hvala.